This episode is brought to you by Geno's East, L.A. Geno's East is one of Chicago's most famous deep dish pizza places. They've been open since 1966. And there are still some people who don't realize Geno's East is here in L.A. now, too. And let me tell you, it feels like you're in Chicago when you're in there. I'm in there most every Friday for happy hour, and it feels like home. Home for us Chicagoans. And a friendly place for people who have never experienced Chicago to get a real feel and real taste for what it is that so many people rave about. I always have a difficult time deciding what to order at Geno's because there's so much great stuff on the menu. My go-to is probably the tavern pizza, cheese and sausage. But when I see someone next to me eating the deep dish, my mouth starts to water. Then I see the Italian beef with jardinara, and I want to snatch it from the waiter's tray. Every friend I take there never leaves without feeling like they just experienced a meal in Chicago. They can't wait for me to invite them back, and I just tell them they can go there without me. Geno's East of Chicago in Los Angeles was named Best Pizza in the Southland by the LA Times readers 2 years in a row. There's half-price bottles of wine on Mondays and Tuesdays, lunch special every weekday, personal size 7-inch deep dish salad, and a pop for $12.95, Italian beef, fries, and a pop for $12.95. That's pretty good. It's more than just a Chicago restaurant. It's one of the best restaurants in L.A. Check out the friendly confines of Geno's East L.A. today on the corner of Coldwater Canyon and Riverside Drive, just off the 101. See you there on Friday sometime.
Sit back and relax. It's time for peanuts, popcorn, and Cracker Jacks.
Hey, how's it going? I'm your host, Jeff Santo, and I'm here with my wife, Christie.
Hello, hello. So we have a new cool Cracker Jack.
Right on. Cool. Woo! Cracker Jack.
And he wrote us a letter as well.
What's his name?
His name is Jim Muehlschlegel.
All right, Jim.
And
welcome.
Here's what he wrote to us. He said, I first met you and your dad at Randy Hunley's fantasy camp in 1994. After that, I had the pleasure of hanging out with him here and there. I've never known another player like your dad, a great guy. Never thought he was better than anyone else. Always took time to talk and listen to me. It's funny how you mention his emotions. One time he invited me up to a party in one of the suites in St. Louis on a Cubs road trip back in 1995. Cubs third base coach Tony Muser and your dad got into a discussion and disagreement about why Rick Wilkins was going through a sophomore slump. Your dad wasn't having any of it and headed back to his room for the night. I was sort of pissed because I was really enjoying his company. Me, just an ordinary guy from Chicago suburbs hanging with Ron Santo.
Yeah, very cool, Jim. Yeah, well, I wonder what that discussion was like because my dad had a bit of a sophomore slump, so I'm sure he knew what was going on with him. Mm. And that was because his diabetes hit.
Was that when
that he had to regulate.
Finally had to get on insulin?
Yeah, had to get on insulin and regulate. And so it was a tough sophomore year. Or was it the year after sophomore year? I think it was 60, 61. It was 62. I was wrong.
It's
because he came up halfway.
Right.
So anyway, so I have something to discuss with you.
Okay.
You know, it's St. Patty's Day.
It is St. Patty's Day because we come out early for our Patreon guests. So.
Yes, and thinking about luck, the luck of the Irish.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and what is luck to you?
Well, we've talked about this before when we were riding Ravens in the Rain.
That's right.
We have two different characters who have different opinions on this. So I'm guessing I know where this is going. You are very superstition based, being from the baseball.
Yeah, I guess.
Okay. I'm kind of more on the philosopher Seneca's kind of point of view on this, that it's like, what's that saying? Luck is what happens when preparation meets opportunity.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. And so that's a good one. I mean, that's kind of the mainstay one. And then bad luck happens when lack of preparation and reality hits.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
but
like.
And also we have, you know, Prue, our character in Ravens in the Rain, she was kind of thinking of it as like a glass half full kind of thing. Like you have a certain amount of luck that you can have before it goes the other way.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is cool. And I think too, like even, you know, the preparation part is, hey, if
if you're not ready, you're not ready. Bad stuff's going to happen. So I think, too, that luck is more of like a chance thing rather than, like, let's say if you put luck in a 9-inning baseball game.
Okay.
All right? Put it in the 9 innings. In those 9 innings, how much does luck play in a 9-inning game? How much do you think the average of what luck would play for a team in those 9-inning games?
Very interesting. I mean, because where does luck come? Luck doesn't come in, you know, catching a, you know, a ball. Because
no.
That's skill.
That's skill.
Right?
Right.
So where's the luck? Is the luck the choice of pitch, you know?
No. That is, you're prepared. So luck, to me, would be like a fan sticking his hand out and the player didn't catch the ball. I'm not doing the... so much the Bartman thing, but I'm just, it happened in New York, and you go, oh my God, that's so lucky they were on a roll that stopped a team from scoring or went the other way. So one team thinks it's lucky. That's a lucky by chance thing that happened.
Or like, let's say there's something with the groundskeeping.
Yeah.
A little
it hit a,
bump it
hit a
in
hole,
the sand.
It hit a bump, and boom, it bounces over
bounces
the player's
on
head.
The laces.
That's kind of like, so how often does that decide a game? Not often. So how often, if you put 9 innings of baseball into the game of life, how often does that help or hurt a life?
Okay, but then say that to the baseball player who wears his underwear 5 times in a row.
Yeah, but that's more superstition. That's more like saying, like, you're thinking about, oh, I didn't do this, so I'm not keeping a streak going. Because that should end once you start slumping, right?
Okay, but luck and superstitions go hand in hand.
Yeah, but I look at luck, if you look at it as like life, like, okay, real luck would be like, oh my God, I didn't fall off that cliff when I should have, right? That's kind of,
or maybe
like,
that's skill because your muscles kept you up.
Maybe, but at the same time, if you really take luck to a deeper level, to me, it's a wake-up call for yourself in life. You're lucky to know that you got by that situation to go to the next and maybe do something different, better, and keep improving yourself, because you got to look at it as your own life, don't you? And you can put luck into a group thing too and say, okay, where's the luck in the team thing, right?
Yeah, I mean, you can say I've had a lot of, you know, very scary moments in my
mm-hmm.
life, and
mm-hmm.
I was lucky,
right,
to get out of those situations.
That's,
I mean,
kind of where I think it lives.
I, you know, by inches, you
yeah.
know, would have been a different scenario,
different thing.
So, you know.
And you could say a chance meeting, they say, you know, it comes from something desirable by chance. I met you by chance. You were very desirable to me.
I was praying to God very strongly to meet you. And so I was time slowed that day. It was a very weird situation. So I kind of put that more in God's hands than luck.
Right. But,
does God have, you know, control over luck? Who knows? I don't know.
Who knows? But if you take the definition of luck, saying, you know, to come up to something desirable by chance, that happened to me. I came up to something desirable by chance in an airport. And now if we weren't ready for each other, then it doesn't work. So then where does luck play in that? We were ready to, like,
mm-hmm.
embrace, because our paths kind of took us to that
place.
So,
yeah. So opportunity and preparation.
Yeah, but
is
that luck, though? Because, you know, it's fortunate, but again,
right. There's a difference between fortunate
is that
and
your
lucky,
life,
you
know?
Your
pet. Yeah. So I look at it as luck is something that, you know, moves you forward to hopefully not go backwards.
But then there's also the luck of, you know, just even being born an American instead of some other countries or some other.
Well,
countries.
Yeah, then, I mean, so that's the fortune of, oh, the draw. I don't even know what to call that. Now we're going into something else
that
is
saying.
Going way into let's another land. All right, yes. And not enough people, yeah, realize that. But yes, there's a lot to it. But if you look at luck in your own being and the people you're with, it has to be more about moving forward and seeing the signs that are good omens to propel you.
Oh, and if you go down the rabbit hole of the omens, I mean, you can go down a... Yeah, that's a whole other...
Well, you know, I mean...
And then
okay.
That gets into superstition land.
I guess, hey, however you can better off be with yourself in life, you've hit some good luck strides. How about that? Because when you hit the bad patch...
So always look at the glass half full.
Ah, there you go. Back to that.
And
all right,
lucky.
Prue is right. There we go. Enjoy the show. It's a good one.
Enjoy.
This podcast is brought to you by Bernie's Tap and Grill. It's family-owned and operated since 1954. Located across from Wrigley Field on Clark and Waveland. My dad hit a few home runs on the Waveland Avenue, and Bernie's was my dad's favorite place to go. It's got delicious food, 4 full-service bars, an awesome beer garden, a sidewalk patio cafe, and a cool upstairs area. It's the place I've always met my friends at before and after games. Go on by and tell Linda Dillman Jeff Santos sent you. Bernie's Tap and Grill, where you go when you go to Wrigley.
My special guest this show came to me by luck. My Irish friend Scott Nelson, by chance or maybe not by chance, texted me a name from the 1969 Cubs team. When I saw his name, I smiled. He was the lead singer of the Pennant Fever record the Cubs recorded that summer. Him and Willie Smith, they could sing. I wore his Cubs basketball jersey because the Cubs had a basketball team in the offseason. And all the jerseys were stored in our basement. He played for the 1963 Los Angeles Dodgers World Series championship team. Nate Oliver, great to have you here, man.
Thank you very kindly, Jeff. Nice to be with you.
Man, I mean, I don't know if I've ever talked to you. I mean, you remember me as a little kid, probably. That was about it.
That is exactly how I remember you, as a little kid, running around with your father and your mother, yes.
Wow, and you got traded to the Cubs in the beginning of the 69 season, am I correct?
That is correct. I got traded to Chicago from the New York Yankees, and I think it was the very first or second week of the season in 69, yes.
That doesn't happen often. Why was that?
The Yankees wanted to bring up Cody Bellinger's father. And so they wanted to make that move. And that's exactly what happened. They brought him up, let me go. Leo called, and I ended up in Chicago with the Cubs.
And what was that like for you, Nate, coming to Chicago with that team?
That team was a special team. It was probably still the best team in the National League, regardless of what the results were. We happened to fall on hard times at the wrong time. But if you can recall, or if you've studied, or if you've researched that entire infield in 1969 at every infield position, started the All-Star game for the National League. That's how great that team was. You know, we had two 20-game winners, 17-game winner in Holtzman. It was the best team. And not on paper. It's just that we hit a tailspin at the wrong time.
Yeah. Well, now, the season itself, I mean, what was the ride like in the beginning of it? Did you know right away when you came there that you were on a special team and this was going to take off?
Well, the things we did, basically, fundamentally, everybody contributed in a number of ways. So you knew right away that you had encountered something that's very special and that some positive things could be in the making as far as the outcome of that season, as far as the Cubs and the regular season itself was concerned. So yes, you could identify right away that there was a special something in that clubhouse.
Wow, yeah, you played on the 63 Dodger team, and you went from start to finish there. Then what did you see happening at the end there, Nate, that was different? Or was there anything different?
No, it's just that with every club during any season, you're going to have a tailspin, regardless how you look at the Dodgers last year in the playoffs.
Mm-hmm.
Win over 100 games, have that layoff, and then can't get it going again, and end up losing to the not the Padres, but the Diamondbacks here. So what actually happens is if you have your tailspin at the wrong time, that's what kills you. And it just so happened that's what happened to us. We hit a tailspin in September. The Mets got on a hot streak in September and rode it all the way to the World Championship.
And what about, I'd like to ask you, because you were on the ride, man. You know, when I ever can talk to someone that was up close and personal on the 69 Cubs ride, I got to talk to them. And I want to ask you a question. You were in the clubhouse there when the Don Young game went down. What happened? What did you see? Was that a big moment?
I didn't really see it, you know, like everybody else. They said your dad said some things to Donnie, wasn't very pleasing as far as Donnie was concerned, or as far as some of the people that witnessed the incident were concerned. I did not see it, unfortunately, for our audience, but it went down the way it went down, and hopefully, you know, everybody after a long run, after a long period of time, everything and everybody was forgiven, because that's the kind of clubhouse we had. And if it was something said or done, it wasn't in malice whatsoever. It was to continue to encourage, hopefully to get us back on the right track, because we're not going to win anything if you don't have those people doing what they do best. And that was probably one of the motives of that issue, was to just hopefully get everybody remotivated and back on track. And it could have been taken out of context by those that wrote the articles or made the comments. I'm not sure, unfortunately, because I was not privy to what took place there.
Yeah. You know, you guys did have a great locker room, man. I mean, as a kid, you just know it by feeling, because kids are like, hey, am I safe in here? What do I feel? I could just remember those days. You guys were just a great group of guys. And when you get to the end of a season like that, though, playing the day baseball and the Mets not having to play as many day games, but did you feel like the Mets, New York, because you played in New York, did they the psychology of it, did they win that game?
You know, it wasn't that at all. It wasn't that at all.
Okay.
It was a simple reaction. It was a tailspin that we could not control. We went down the bank and we just could not regroup whatsoever. If you remember, I think, don't quote me, but I think on September 5th or early September, we had a 5-game lead. Mm-hmm. We hit that tailspin, and if you, a lot of people have not read about it or studied it, we went on a minus 13 game losing streak. Mm-hmm. 13 consecutive games to begin the month of September. The Mets, I think, if my memory serves me right, won something like maybe 14 out of 17 or 15 out of 18. Just a ridiculous hot streak compared to a ridiculous cold streak.
Yeah, right.
We couldn't do anything correctly. No, and the timing, it was the timing. The timing was wrong for us. The timing was right for them.
Yeah, you're right on with that, because I did study it, and right when Woodstock was happening, that's when it happened.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever, the wind shifted, and you guys did lose. I don't know if you lost 13 in a row, but you lost a lot of. Yeah.
Well, I remember for sure, if you look out and study it, we did lose 13 in a row.
Wow, really? Okay, I thought it was like 13 out of like 15 or 16. I didn't know it was 13 in a row.
It might have been that in the end, but initially we lost it. The 13th game that we lost was after we left New York to Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
And those three games that we lost in Philly. Well, that last game made 13 in a row for us.
Yeah, when you went into New York, in September, when the Black Cat came out on the dugout.
The Black Cat went right across that on-deck circle.
Yeah.
And I think, if my memory serves me right, your dad was in the on-deck circle. Am I correct?
Yeah, you are correct. He was in the
circle.
I think
he was. Yes.
Yeah.
Right. And what it did, it took you back to 1947, 48, some of the stuff that happened to Jack. And one of those things was a Black Cat situation. He ended up actually getting the cat and holding the cat and kind of nurturing the cat, if my memory serves me correct.
Basically, I think you're right, yeah.
It was the same thing. There was a black cat involved in a negative way.
Wow. Right. Holy cow, I didn't even put that together, but I do remember now.
Yeah.
You say that. Yes. And now, Nate, during the season, when you guys were rocking and rolling, that song that you did, which is beautiful. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, the Bears did it in 85 and they won the Super Bowl. You guys just so happened didn't get there. But what was that like? You and Willie Smith took over. That was really cool.
That all started, you know how the clubhouse you start chopping it up, and then all of a sudden somebody said, "You and Willie should make an album." What are you talking about, make an album? Well, I think the people involved in pushing that thing was your dad, Gene Oliver, and I want to say Spangler. I want to say Al for some reason, I'm not sure. But at any rate, they put it together. We went to the studio, and we recorded the song from That Loving Feeling by the Righteous Brothers. And all we did was, we only changed the lyrics, the melody, everything else. Everything else was exactly the same. Only the lyrics were changed because the lyrics dealt with what we were doing at the time as far as Cub Fever.
Yeah, that was outstanding. Yeah, that was something. And what was it like when you guys, it was over, you cut it. What'd you think of it?
We thought it was pretty good. We didn't really think it was going to be as good as it was because a lot of Willie had a tremendous baritone voice, and then I did the second tenor part, and then the rest of the guys sang background, and it came out a whole lot better than any of us ever anticipated. So it was pretty cool to have done something
really
like
cool.
that. But it was, you know, it was very depressing to come out on the short end after being in the position and being in first place for so many months and so many days and falter at the end.
Yeah. Yeah, man. And you backed up Beckert a little bit in that season, right?
Yes.
Because he got hurt, didn't he, for a little bit?
Beck got hurt for a while, and then I backed him up for a minute. And then the Dodgers, I'm sorry, forgive me, it is the Dodgers, but the Cubs traded for, what's his name, the switch hitter?
Popovich? Paul Popovich?
It was Popo. Popo came in from L.A. He got traded from L.A. And took over until Glenn got healthy, yes.
Right. Now, your career, your dad played in Negro Leagues. And did your brother play too?
My brother played in the Cardinal organization in A-ball and in our hometown of St. Petersburg, Florida. Yes, he did.
Oh, that's great. Now, what was that like when you were growing up? Did you go to a lot of those games? Is that how you got involved really early? How did that go for you?
Well, he would go away and then return and go away and return. So at this moment, sometime at 44, 45, he just decided enough was enough. So he decided to retire and stay home. And what he did, he started some local semi-pro teams, and he just taught and trained a whole bunch of people. A couple of you may be familiar with or may not be, but Ed Charles, who played in that 69 World Series with the New York Mets, was trained by my father, along with another young man who received a cup of coffee with the Boston Red Sox during that time period, a second baseman by the name of George Smith. My dad just started training everybody, and those of us that caught on and were blessed to get to the big dance, he had a lot to do with that. So it was quite an experience because you got three guys from a very small southern town. And we were blessed enough to make it to the big dance and spend some time there.
What was he? What did he feel when you got there? What was it like seeing your dad's face? What happened then?
Well, he was just the kind of guy that not because it was my dad, but he was just the kind of guy that, loved to see any and everyone have some success, and to have three guys to be able to get to the big dance under his tutelage. It was quite an honor. It was quite an honor for him.
Amazing. Amazing. And you played, now you were on a 65 Dodger team. You were on the Dodgers for what, 5 years?
Yes. 5.5 years.
And
yeah.
So, yeah. And in the 65 team, when Sandy Koufax pitched a perfect game against the Cubs. Now you didn't play that much. Did you get hurt?
I wasn't playing in that game. I had gotten injured, and then Jim looked, I don't know what happened, but yeah, I had gotten hurt. Wasn't playing very much, but on that particular night, Sandy started out, boom, 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 boom. And then after a while, we realized something special is going on here, people. So in the Dodger dugout, the three steps that led up to the on-deck circle sat Walter Austin, the manager, right behind those steps. One of the clubhouse men or one of the grounds crew had made an armrest for him. So that's where he sat, and that's where he conducted business. However, when things started to develop the way they developed, I moved down to the steps. And I just kind of literally stayed there the entire game. You would think that I'm in the way of the skipper and sort of kind of blocking his view to a degree. But because of all those zeros that begun to go up on that scoreboard, he never made me move. And I remember that very well.
Yeah, you couldn't move, right?
You were not allowed to move from whatever position you had occupied during that time because of the superstitions that we possessed in those days. Wherever you were when it all started is where you were going to be when it ends. And that's where I ended up.
Let me
tell you a little bit about this whole thing.
Please do.
Boom, 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 boom. You know, in one inning after the other, 1, 2, 3, strikeout, ground ball, pop. I mean, nothing that even resembled a hard hit ball. Now we're in the top of the ninth, and Koufax is going to face three Hall of Famers in the top of the ninth inning. He's going to start out with Billy Williams, batting third, Ron Santo batting fourth, and Ernie Banks batting fifth in the top of that ninth inning. It was so electric, Jeff. It was just simply unbelievable. Because what he did was, I want you to listen very carefully to me. He threw nine fastballs, and the perfect game was history.
Oh, my God. That's unbelievable. I didn't know that story.
He threw nine fastballs. That's it. There were no balls in that inning. There were all nine fastball strikes. Swinging
strikes. Right by them. Oh, my God. Yeah. That's unbelievable. Yeah. The way I had no idea. Oh, thank you for telling me that.
Holy cow. Simply amazing. I had the opportunity to speak with Jeff Tallborg, who caught that perfect game, and he assured me emphatically over and over. He said, Peely, I put my glove down at the knees of every one of those hitters and every one of those pitches. And when I received the balls, all nine of them, they were letter high. And they told me a baseball couldn't rise.
Oh, my God. That's outstanding. Holy cow.
Oh, he was simply amazing. He was something very, very, very special. Yeah.
Do you know that the lineup for the Cubs that day and – to witness it like you did, that's amazing. They did have a little bit. They had an 8mm camera that caught part of that. Later, they showed it. The Dodgers did, and with no sound, right? But you could just see them just walking back to the dugout. You know, boom.
It was something. It was something.
Yeah.
And you know how people make the comment at times when something occurs, it makes the hair stand up on the back of your neck.
Right.
To witness that whole thing. Firsthand makes the hair stand up. Even today, just thinking about that, because I can see it as vivid as it was on the day it occurred.
Oh, right there. I'm you telling me the story, I got my hairs are standing up. And when I saw that 8mm or 16mm footage, same thing happened. Mm-hmm. I'm like, you were in that world to witness that right on the dugout steps is amazing.
Yes.
And you know, the lineup of that game for the Cubs, which is, I looked it up. I couldn't believe Don Young led off the game. Don Young came mm-hmm. up that year in 65 for like five games, and that was it. Then he never mm-hmm. came until 69. Pretty wild. They had Young leading off, Beckert second, Billy third, my dad fourth, Ernie fifth, and then these two guys I don't know, Brian Brown, and then Chris Krug was the catcher. Brian Brown was the left fielder.
Was it Brant Brown or Brown? Byron Brown.
Byron Brown. Yeah, Byron Brown.
I remember Byron Brown. Who was the other one?
Chris Krug was the catcher. And then
I don't have very much on those two guys, but Where was Kess hitting?
Kessinger was hitting eighth, and then Bob mm-hmm. Henley pitched a one hitter that game, so there was only one hit in that game that set a record for the least amount of hits in a 9-inning game.
I got some more news for you, my friend. That one base hit, was an excuse me swing.
Yeah.
Maury Wills, I think Maury Wills walked.
Wow.
Stole second base. And if my memory serves me correct, there was a high fastball that I want to say Lou Johnson was playing by then late in 65. And he turned to get out of the way of the pitch. The ball hit his bat and hit the edge of the outfield grass and went out in the right field. That's it. It was an excuse me swing. We scored one run, and that's all Koufax needed. That's it. Bob Henley also had a tremendous night on that night. How many hits did we get? Two, three, four?
One. It was a record. One hit.
Well, I tell you, it was an excuse me swing. It was a check swing, that's how that whole thing unfolded.
Yeah. You know, and you flip Kessinger, then became the leadoff hitter, and then you add, you know, Randy Hundley in there, and then Jim Hickman, and then mm-hmm. you guys surrounding that.
That's
the team was really basically the same for those, you know, besides getting Bill Hands and stuff like that. But you look at a team like that, that's why they were ready. They played a lot of years together, especially my dad, Ernie, and Billy, you know? Mm-hmm.
And Kess and Beck.
Since 65.
Ernie and Billy, they were the nucleus. You know, you always have to have five guys that can toe the rubber every single day. And those were they. They were the five guys that were the nucleus of that club that you knew was going to be in that lineup every single day.
In the same spot. Yeah.
Yep.
Yep. Did you think Leo played them too many games?
No, I don't.
Okay.
We were just
I didn't think that either.
You know, we were so excited. I mean, and we were winning, and you don't really get that tired when you're winning. You can't wait to get to the ballpark. You can't wait to begin your activities, your work, and all that. No, it was really euphoria until the middle of September or whatever happened in September.
Right. Yeah. Well, what a pleasure to talk to you, Nate. And how did it go from there after baseball? You got into coaching for a long time, right?
I did, and I'm still doing it. I'm involved in two programs. We are trying to bring black youngsters back into baseball. I'm involved in a program in Birmingham, Alabama. And it's called the Piper Davis Foundation. Piper Davis gave Mr. Plum his blessings. You can use the Piper Davis name as long as you're doing something to help young people. Our motto, we try to get young people into college through this program. And we have a tournament every year in July in Birmingham. The second thing I'm involved in is we're training little people in baseball. In the Oakland Unified School District, we have our program runs all day on Saturday and 2 or 3 days a week at several of the schools, the elementary schools. We train 0 to 2nd grade from 9 a.m. to 12 noon. And then we bring in the third through 5th graders from 1 o'clock to 4 p.m. That's every Saturday in the city of Oakland. I'm still involved in that. After 44 years of refereeing high school, college, and little people basketball, still doing a little bit of that. And employed by the city of Oakland, recreation department.
Well, Nate, that sounds wonderful, man. And you sound like, I mean, wow, like you're 50 or something. Who knows? That just sounds so strong, man. And what a great life and career, baseball life you had, man. I mean, from a little boy, still doing it. It's beautiful, man. I'm giving back. Yeah. So great to talk to you, Nate. Thank you so much for coming on my show.
You too, Jeff. God bless you. Take care.
You too, man. Take care. All right, Nate.
Bye.
This Santo Moment is brought to you by Onesti Entertainment. On September 9th, 1969, Ron Santo was on deck in Shea Stadium when a black cat appeared from out of nowhere, circled Ron, then went to the lip of the dugout and stared directly at Leo the Lip DeRocher. The Cubs went on to lose both games in New York and eventually fall out of first place to the Miracle Mets. That factoid, or Santoid, was brought to you by Onesti Entertainment.
Crackerjack.
This Hello? Call is being recorded.
Joey Hickman.
Jeff Santo, what's up, buddy?
Hey, man, you're my crackerjack call. I catch you the wrong time.
I just driving down the road with my wife, but we're almost home, so this is good.
Right on, man. Tell you what, man, I was thinking about you because I listened to this game. I don't know if I told you about it. There's a game in 1969 that you can get online on YouTube. It's a classic baseball national radio broadcast game of the Montreal Expos playing the Cubs at Wrigley. And that's the game your dad hit the home run to win the game, and my dad clicked his heels from it.
I got that picture, man. I love it.
Oh, man, you got to listen to it. I got chills. It was unbelievable. They were down 6-3 in the ninth inning. And my dad was up with, like, Billy was on first. I think Beck was on second, and he hit a hard shot to the right side. They made a good play, but it went to second and third, two outs. That was two outs. And then Ernie came up, and Ernie gets a base hit, the two-run score, still two outs. Ernie's on first. Your dad comes up, 2-1 count. Bam, place went nuts. National radio broadcast. You got to listen to it. I still got chills from this morning listening to it again. So,
I've got to do that.
Anyway, man.
That's incredible.
Hey, tell me about, you know, your dad playing for the Cubs, what it was like for your family. Tell me a little about that.
Jeff, that's a loaded question. I'll do what I can. I always tell everybody when I would talk about it not long after my dad retired, I never really knew that he was playing professional baseball. Because all of our friends that we ran around with in Chicago when we were living there in the summers, was you guys, you know, it was players, children. We ran around with you guys. We hung out. We came over to each other's houses. I didn't know anything was crazily different, you know.
Right.
Looking back, awesome memories. My dad was honored to be a member of that team for 6 years. They treated him with respect and class, and even upon his passing in 2016, Jeff, they sent a big wreath made in the Cubs logo, and just an awesome organization. And he loved the Cubs. He loved every part of it. It was just pretty incredible. I grew up thinking nothing abnormal about it, and it wasn't until long after he retired, and I was in the middle of a cotton field going, man, 2 weeks ago I was in St. Louis, and now here I am in a cotton field. What in the world is wrong with this?
Right. When it ends, boy, it's over, right?
That was a tough adjustment, I'll be honest with you.
Did you want to play ball, Joey?
I did, Jeff, but I explain it this way. I was slow, I couldn't throw it very hard, and I couldn't hit for power. Other than that, I was a great ball player.
I hear you, man, especially when you look at your dad, a big guy, was hitting home runs. Same here, man. I'm, you know, I could hit, but, you know, could I play third like my pops? No. But, you know, and it's a different mindset too, right? I mean, we had the way we grew up versus how they grew up, you know, a little different.
I'll speak in defense of you for just a minute. There's not many people that have ever played baseball that could play third base like your pops. I can think of one right offhand, Brooks Robinson.
Mm-hmm.
There's not many, brother. I'm telling you.
Yeah, man. You know, yeah, he was a great third baseman. And your dad, man, he really was like this power hitter that a lot of people didn't really know about. But you know, you were in Chicago, followed the 69 team. You did, and other people did. But he also, you know, your dad was such a gentleman, man. I remember in the clubhouse, he was always just a nice guy, you know? You know, I think that season, that team that they had with your dad hitting right after Ernie, I mean, it's just unfortunate they didn't win it. And the next year, your dad had an MVP kind of year. He hit like 32 home runs, 115 RBIs. He got the winning hit in the All-Star game. So, I mean, you know, we almost got that big dance, but we just didn't quite get there, did we?
It's a shame. It's a shame we didn't win it. You know, honestly, I don't know what you point the finger at, but it just wasn't meant to be for some reason. I mean, you go into September with a big lead and you come out way behind. I mean, whatever it was, it just wasn't meant to happen. And you know, didn't mean we loved them any less, but. Gosh, what a great memory that would have been.
Yeah, it sure would have, man. And what does your dad think of Leo? Did he like him?
Dad loved Leo. And Jeff, it has more to do with what happened after baseball than it did during baseball.
Mm-hmm.
When my dad fell on hard times farming, Leo was one of the first ones to call and offer him some money. Now, my dad didn't take it. He was too prideful to take it.
Mm.
But that meant the world to him. And you know, I think it spoke a lot about their relationship as manager and ball player, you know. Leo had his faults. Who doesn't? But he stepped up big for my dad, and dad really respected him for that.
Wow, that's cool, man. Holy cow. Yeah, man. For you, man, and your family, how many brothers do you have?
I have three brothers. Two older and one younger. My oldest brother passed away in October. He had some health issues, passed away of cancer, but he was Jim Jr.
Really sorry about that. We talked about that. Yeah.
Thank you. He was a good big brother. You know, I got close to him later in life, especially after my dad passed away, and we had a real good relationship.
Who was most like your father?
I would say Jim Jr. You know,
okay.
He tried to play minor league ball for 1 year, and just like me and my other brothers, not fast enough. He could hit, he could throw, but just wasn't very fast, and just couldn't find a place for him to play. You know, my youngest brother was the biggest out of all of us. My dad was 6'4", my youngest brother 6'3". He probably could have had it, but he discovered girls early on, and that kind of ended his baseball days.
Mm. And you, man, you're professional golfer, golf pro, right?
I've been a PGA pro since 1991. It's near and dear to my heart. I'm actually the president of the Tennessee section of the PGA of America. So pretty cool there, holding office.
Awesome,
in
man.
Tennessee. 8-year commitment. I'm in my fifth year of 8 years. You do 2 years as secretary, VP, president, and past president. So a total of 8 years. I enjoy doing it. I enjoy teaching. I enjoy coaching. I've just been around the game, and it's all because of the Cubs. You know, Ray Floyd used to work out with the Cubs, and
right.
I grew up following his career, and Dad got a bunch of stuff from Ray, and he'd bring it home, and I'd toy around with it and go out in the yard and play with it, and fell in love with golf, and here I am making a career out of it.
Well, that's great, man. So baseball, when you kind of knew it, you kind of took over golf, and that became your passion, that became your sport. How old were you when you made that transition?
You know, I started playing when I was 8, but probably when I was about 12, my parents would take me to our little 9-hole golf course there in the town we grew up in, and I would just hang out there all day. I'd play as much golf as I could until I got hot, then I'd go jump in the pool and cool off and go play some more. I had buddies that played with me all the time. And small town, you know, there weren't a lot of people playing golf, so.
Right.
Kind of kept me off the streets, kept me out of trouble, and gave me something to be passionate about other than being a Cub fan, you know?
Right, right. That's awesome, man, because it's hard. You think about it after how we grow up in baseball. It's like, what are you going to do? What do you pick, right? It's got to be something that's challenging and something that exactly. that has a bit of a dream in, because we grew up in that dream, right? Do you feel exactly. that way?
Exactly. I would have loved to have played baseball, Jeff. I mean, who wouldn't? I grew up idolizing all these players that the Cubs had, and bear in mind, for the people listening, we didn't have ESPN back in those days. We had Game of the Week on NBC, and occasionally we'd catch it on WGN living in Chicago. But, you know, we knew the Cubs. I knew everybody in that lineup. I idolized those guys, and I would sit at Beckert's feet at his locker. Johnny
right.
Callison, Billy Williams, Ernie Banks, Ron Santo, mm-hmm. Joe Pepitone, Randy Hundley. I mean, just think about the guys that were on that team.
That'd be coming
incredible.
In 70. Yeah. Yeah.
Just incredible.
Did you guys live in Chicago during the season? How'd that play out for the family?
We did. We moved up when school was out, like the first or second week of May. And we would start school in the fall. And then about the end of September, we would go home maybe a week or two before Dad finished the season, and we'd transfer schools.
Okay.
Sad thing about all that, Jeff, I would go to Chicago in May. Everybody in Chicago would tease me about my Southern hick accent. And by the time I got home in September, everybody in Tennessee was teasing me about my Northern Chicago accent. So it was a nonstop tease the little redneck with the funny voice, you know. It was pretty funny at the time.
That's classic, Joey. And Tennessee has been your home, like your dad's home growing up, and that's where you guys made home base?
Right. All the family is in West Tennessee, just
okay.
north of Memphis, about an hour north of Memphis. My wife and I and our kids have been in Nashville, Tennessee now for 28 years.
That's great.
This is home. It's about 220 miles from my home.
Right.
North of Memphis, and my wife's home in Jackson, Tennessee. It's about 150 miles from that. But we love Nashville. It's a booming city, and a lot of golf courses up here. And it's a good place to raise a family.
That's awesome, Joey. It's great getting together with you when you and your wife came out to L.A., man. Love seeing you. I think the last time we saw each other was at, I think, one of the fantasy camps, right?
Yeah, it was one of the first ones that they had.
Yeah, one of the first ones, man. And, but, you know, great memories, pal. And it's so good to hear that you're doing great and you're golf pro. It's amazing, man. Good stuff to hear, you know, a fellow son of a professional baseball player, man. Very cool.
I just got to be honest with you, Jeff. Just getting caught up with you, it's just opened up a bunch of memories of my childhood and being a fan, running around the clubhouse, running around left field. All of those things that we used to do, and just thought it was a normal part of a typical childhood. We didn't know what we were actually getting to do at the time.
Right.
And,
I know.
Looking back on it, I just have such fond memories of all of that. I still remember coming to you guys' house there on the lake and watching
right.
my dad fully dressed, get on the diving board and jump into the lake. And you know, just a lot of memories just rekindled, just hooking up with you. Out in California.
It sure does, man. Because you don't get a chance to talk to people who grew up like we did, right? You got the Banks kids, and it's not like we hung out after that, right? So everyone goes their separate ways, and you know, here we are kind of coming back and seeing what each other has done and, you know, talk about our families and the whole journey. And, you know, so it's, it's great for me too, man. And I hope you said you're going to start a podcast. I hope you do, man. You got a lot to talk about in golf and baseball and your whole life, man. So I hope you start.
I have just started it. I got about my fourth episode will drop tonight. Doing one a week. We're talking a lot about golf, a lot about faith, a lot about life. Just different people that I feel led to share their stories about. And we'll get in deep into some coaching, deep into some philosophies of what you do with your players, and not just in golf, but also in football, baseball, basketball, all different walks of life. I'm trying to get inside the mind of the athlete and just, you know, how do we harness that? How do we teach that to our students, and how do we learn from it?
Right, man. It's the psychology of the games is amazing. That's what it takes, man, to really have that mental strength, you know, to compete to the right way too, you know? So, I love that kind of stuff, man. That's what I dive into on the show, you know, and even breaking down 1969 psychologically, right? Holy cow.
Yeah. So, yes. I know this is part of your podcast, but when I found your podcast, and I don't remember how I found it, I'll be honest with you, Peanuts, Popcorn, and Cracker Jack. I just thought, what a snazzy name. I listened to some episodes, and I've gone back. You've got about 36 or 37 episodes. I've gone back, and I've listened to about half of those, and listening to Billy Williams, listening to Randy Hunley, listening to Todd Hunley, one of your Cracker Jacks.
Right.
Just the different things that bring back those memories from 1969, you know, and even 68 to 73. Dad was on that team with with your dad, and Billy Williams, and Don Kessinger, and Glenn Beckert. I think it's one of the greatest teams ever assembled. And to have those memories come back to the forefront, what your podcast has done for me has helped me to do that. I've always been a Cub fan, Jeff. I've always loved Chicago. Anytime I go back up to the city, I just sit there and I look at it and I go, wow, I did this as a kid. I miss it so much. But, you know, it's a wonderful thing. Hope springs eternal. Your podcast is helping me get into this new Cubs team. And, man, I'm excited.
Right on, man.
I am fired up. I am looking forward to the season just like any other season. And I'm thankful for those years we had, 2015 to 2022, 2021.
Yep.
We were in the playoffs every year. But, you know, teams that go way back when our dads were playing, you know, there was American League and National League prior to 1969. One team from
right.
each league made
yeah.
it. You know, yeah. it was a lot harder to make it back then. I think, Jeff, if the 69 team would have been playing in the modern setup with playoffs and the numbers of teams and all that stuff, they might have snagged one or two of those world championships.
Right.
Who knows?
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
It just wasn't meant to be. Now we can just
it
watch
was,
this
yeah.
team and we can get excited.
Yeah. A lot harder to get there, exactly, you know. And 69 was the first year and thought they were getting there. But, boy, those Mets, man, you got to take a close look at what they did in September. It's crazy. So
they had an incredible, incredible run. While I'm thinking about
it, I
told you this when I saw you in California, but I'm gonna tell you in your audience how proud my dad was when your dad got into the Hall of Fame.
Mm.
The fact that it took that long is an injustice to the name Ron Santo, but the fact that he's in there now, man, I'm so happy for your family. I just think it was long overdue. I know it probably wore under your dad's collar, but I listened to some of the stats that you and Billy shared about your dad, about their games played together, and it was an injustice that your dad was not put in first ballot Hall of Fame first year of eligibility. And I'm not just saying that because you're Jeff Santo. I would say that to anybody. Ron Santo was unjustly held out of the Hall of Fame, and I'm so glad he's in there now.
Ah, thanks, Joe. That means a lot, man.
Special dude your dad was, I'm telling you.
Yeah, he sure was, man. And your dad, too, man. They had a cool friendship, you know. They really did.
They did.
Your dad was a quiet power, you know. and did the job every day, you know, and those guys respected each other a ton, you know, so you could just tell.
I called Don Kessinger after my dad passed away, and I asked him to share a couple of stories with me about my dad and just take his time and call me when he was ready. And he called me about a week later, and he said, one of the things that stood out to me about your dad was this. I would look at Hick, and I would say, Hick, we need a hit now. Man, just go up there and pick you out a good pitch and just get a good hit. He said, your dad would look at me and go, Kess, I'm going to do the best that I can do, and that's all I can do. And he'd walk out of the dugout, and he'd go up there, and he'd swing the bat like he had a mission, you know. And I guess that was just coming from a small town. He didn't know any other way. He was
right.
He was humble. He was humble, and he went out, and man, he had fun. He had fun playing with the Cubs. It was phenomenal. I don't know if he had as much fun in New York his first 5 years playing for the Mets. I mean, playing for that expansion team could not be easy.
But no, right, and then seeing them, and then seeing them on the tail end at 69, yeah, that's definitely not easy, right? Being there when they were horrible and going, holy cow, they're coming on strong. And, you know, you get back to also what you're saying about the Hall of Fame, my dad, and I love that your dad said that, man. Wow, that's amazing. That's just awesome. And
a lot of your dad,
Jeff. Yeah, well, thank you, man. I just, to me, it's like, you know, he doesn't get in because – they didn't win it. They win it, maybe it's a different ball game, you know? And, you know, that had a lot to do with it, I think. Never getting there, you know? Especially when three other guys are getting in, you know? But that's the cool thing. We can look back now and learn so much from our father's past, you know? And that to me, gives me more strength. And I'm sure it does the same for you.
It does. It really does. You look, your career, what you've done, I cannot imagine the time that you got to spend with your dad preparing to do this old Cub and the stories that you got to relive once again as a young man. Or you were what, in your 30s when you started that? Late 30s maybe?
Late 30s.
So a totally different perspective on your dad's career and the stories. And, you know, I just...
Thanks, man. But the thing is, it's weird. When I did this old Cub, I was amazing how that came together. A lot to do with my mother, you know, pushing me in that direction, and it being my second film. But, you know, I think when my dad passed, and I'm sure same with you, it's really you almost go to another level, and you start thinking of them from afar and wondering how they did what they did, you know, to kind of keep you moving forward and. In your life today, that's the part where I'm like, wow, I even got another perspective from the time that I worked so hard on this old Cub that they're
that's
gone.
Pretty cool. I got a story I want to share with you that Phil Regan shared at my dad's funeral, and I'll give you the Reader's Digest version. He's up there telling a story about my dad facing Nolan Ryan and said he stood in the back corner of the box and put the bat on his shoulder. My dad had this wide stance and, Nolan threw the first ball, strike one. Threw the second ball, strike two. Threw the third ball, strike three. And said my dad, without batting an eye, turned around and looked at the ump and said, Mr. Ump, those first two, they were strikes. But that third one sounded a little high to me. And everybody in the church, there's about 350 people in this church, they are dying out laughing.
Oh, that's great.
And I asked Phil after the deal, I said, did my dad really have his eyes closed? He said, I don't know, but he sure told that joke like he did.
Oh, that's funny. I died.
Oh, I swear.
That's a great story, buddy. Oh, man. Well, great talking to you, Joey. All right, man. Stay in touch.
Jeff, I will. Go Cubs, go. Let's bring it home this year, brother.
Go Cubs, man. And then I ever get to Nashville, I'm calling you up. I've never been out there, but I do want to get there one day, brother.
You'd love it. We got a place for you. You and Christie right come. We'd love to have you stay with us.
Ah, perfect. Perfect. All right, pal. Talk to you soon. Give love to the family.
Love you, man. Thank you, dude.
All right.
All right, you too,
pal.
Same too.
See you, buddy.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Hey, thanks for listening to our show. And I want to put out there Joey Hickman's podcast is called J3 is the name of it. They talk faith, fairways, and philosophies of teaching and coaching. Check it out. Joey's a great guy. And thank you to our cool Cracker Jacks, Scott Nelson, Jim McCauley, Debbie Foley, Sherry Matarisi, Terry Rankin-Gurovitz, Terry O'Brien, Gary Tallman, Anne-Marie Pascule, and Jim Muehlschlegel.
This show is made possible because of all of them and all of our subscribers. If you want to support the show and be a cool Cracker Jack yourself, subscribe on our Patreon page. Click the link below this episode or go to our Patreon tab on our website, www.peanutspopcornandcrackerjacks.com.
Remember to click the follow button for the next episode and leave a review on Apple Podcasts or Spotify.
And don't hesitate to write. Give us suggestions. Tell us how you're liking the show. Email jeff.ppcpodcast@gmail.com.
For my closing quote, every day is a new opportunity. You can build on yesterday's success or put its failures behind and start over again. That's the way life is, with a new game every day. And that's the way baseball is. Bob Feller.
Toodaloo!
SantoFilms.com, the place to buy This Old Cub DVDs, posters, and This Old Cub t-shirts. Get yourself one now at SantoFilms.com.
You'll never drink a pill any more as in day gone by. The old single man and a corner have turned shy. It's running, hitting, and sliding harder while on. The glove has shined this year for you. If you went only thank them like you used to do, yeah. You got a team, a team, a team you don't see every day. Yes, we know.